In a world with so many movies to choose from, one hero will rise. Ladies and gentlemen,
the Movie Wire Podcast with Justin
Vincent. Fragile. It must be Italian.
I'm Buddy the Elf.
We're gonna have the happiest Christmas.
Merry Christmas, you filthy animal. And a Happy New Year.
Oh my God, I shot my eye out.
I give you the Griswold Family Christmas.
I say bah, humbug.
Happy holidays and welcome to this week's Oh So Jolly edition to the Movie Wire. I'm your host, Justin Henson, and we have a great show this week with four brand new reviews, including two Christmas movies that one will be naughty and one will be nice. This week on the show, Santa Claus is coming to town to kick the crap out of the naughty in Violent Night. Ralphie returns in the follow-up to the 1983 Christmas classic A Christmas Story in A Christmas Story Christmas. Based on the true story of bravery in America's Forgotten War, these two pilots made history in devotion. And finally, a family tries to win over their aunt's inheritance, and where there's a will, there's a war, in the new film available on streaming, The Estate. Ready for my verdict? Let's get into it.
Out of the windows to watch, a roar and a burst of flame.
The Movie Wire Podcast.
You need people like me.
The Wire.
And here we go.
The follow-up to 1983's Christmas classic A Christmas Story. This follows the now-adult Ralphie, played by the original actor Peter Billingsley, as he returns to the house of the Cleveland Street to give his kids a magical Christmas like the one he had as a child, reconnecting with childhood friends and reconciling the passing of his old man.
Oh, life moves fast. One day you're playing kick the can with kids named Flick and Schwartz. And the next thing you know, you're a certified adult.
Ralph! Ralph, dear old man.
Fragile.
He was the best.
Ralphie, promise me we're going to make this a wonderful Christmas. That would make your father so happy.
I promise. What had I done? And now it was all up to me?
I suggest you start drinking and don't stop till New Year's.
Hey, kids. Who wants to go see Santa?
This is amazing.
Incredible.
We will meet you right here when you're done.
Don't let him kick you in the face.
Huh?
It's the happy season.
No, when it's just us decorating, it kind of feels like child labor.
Honey, it's not labor if we don't pay you.
Yeah.
Cheers.
There'll be much mistletoe.
My dad made this all look so easy.
That doesn't mean it was easy.
The most wonderful time of the year.
Schwartz, I triple dog dare ya!
Oh, I got him now.
Get out of there!
That's brutal.
It's the most wonderful time.
Slowly I could feel the Christmas ember beginning to glow again.
Now, before we get into the review, let's just forget about the awful 2012 Christmas Story sequel. Let's just forget it ever happened and consider this a follow-up to the Bob Clark 1983 Christmas classic. What made the first Christmas Story so successful is that it was full of pure childlike heart, honesty, and innocence. Telling the story of a Christmas experience through the narration and the eyes of a child gave audiences a Christmas crescendo to the big morning that all of us couldn't wait for, and that was Christmas morning. And it gave us all the holiday feels leading up to it. I still remember the TNT network growing up playing 24 hours of A Christmas Story that would play round the clock at least one TV at my house. Now, Peter Billingsley is back to reprise his role. The big question is, does he still have the same magic as he did as a little kid? Does he still create a sense of innocence? It's been a while since we have seen Billingsley carry a movie into a leading role. The last we have really seen from him is playing a Tony Stark scientist in the original Iron Man and a cameo in Spider-Man Far From Home. It's so hard to capture lightning in a bottle for a second round, especially 39 years later, but Billingsley does a decent job here. Though you can tell at parts he's a little out of practice and the performance can come across amateurish and a little cringy at times. But the thing is, it works here with trying to recreate the innocence of Chritmas even as an adult. For the most part, his performance gives us a looking glass and a vision of how our Ralphie turned into a loving father, a general feeling of a nice guy, and dare I say it, almost a man-child. There is a sense of comfort rather than confidence when he delivers his lines that comes across just genuine, and that's probably due in part the fact that he helped write the story alongside Nick Shake, who also wrote 2021's Cry Macho, 2014's The Judge, and 2008's Gran Torino. Between these two, there is a good contrast of vision. But the thing with writing a Chritmas story sequel is that most of us grew up with the material and have a lot of love for the movie to truly respect the subtleties of it. Now, Ralphie wants desperately to give his kids a Chritmas that he had when he was in Cleveland. Even after receiving the news of his old man's passing, played by the late great Darren McGavin, who passed away back in 2006. What the writers do well here is not make Ralphie's motivation a completely copycat to his old man's character, but rather treat it as a son that just lost his father, and knows he needs to step up not as a replacement but as support for his family. This is where the film can get a little caught up in its laser focus to ensure that Ralphie stands on his own, that it misses some emotional element of loss, and we even miss a background of what previous Ralphie Parker's Chritmas looks like before his old man's death. The biggest things fans will eat up, of course, is the nostalgic feeling when we see our original cast members return and reunite with Ralphie, and how they interact together after all these years. This is another piece where the film controls itself into a false sense of emotion and not going overboard with its overdramatic scenes as a reunion. We still get the nostalgic feels from these characters without them overstaying their welcome. And when these characters are reunited, it creates a subtlety of emotion of running into old friends over a long period of time. The original Chritmas story was told through the eyes of a child, but now the filmmakers have to ensure the same feels of Chritmas magic through the eyes of an adult. There is a scene that I truly did appreciate, and that's where the Parker family visits the same mall from the original to have their kids visit Santa, while the adults go and complete their Chritmas shopping. As the family looks through the display window of all the toys, director Clay Cadis takes his time to really let the looks of awe set in with our characters. And the movie asks a question, as we grow older, do we still have the same Chritmas magic feeling as we do as kids? Some would say no, but my rebuttal is we do, but it's a different kind of Chritmas feeling. It's a Chritmas feeling we live through our kids, we see it through our kids' eyes, and we take our Chritmas experiences and desperately look at our kids and stress if our kids are going to have the same feeling that we did at their age, and if not, a better sense of wonder. We as adults live the Chritmas feeling through our kids, and it's not about the gifts we receive, but rather the experience we give our children to truly remember Chritmas as Ralphie did. Now, Clay Cadis was a great choice for portraying an innocence of the holiday. His previous works consisted of the Angry Birds movie, the Netflix original Chritmas Chronicles, and two Snoopy holiday specials. It doesn't seem like a lot, but the projects he takes on does have special meaning, and you can tell he takes these limited projects on because he's close to these topics. He does a great job keeping the movie on point with consistency of tone, but at times it does lack with actually utilizing the camera appropriately to really take in the emotional response from our characters when needed. But as we get into the last half of the movie, this is where we see our filmmaker's true intent of giving us the buildup of a Chritmas chaos to deliver the Chritmas message of love, redemption, and togetherness. A Chritmas Story Chritmas isn't going to live up to the Chritmas magic of the original, and it surely won't become a Chritmas classic, but it does a fantastic job standing on its own as a respectable follow-up to the original. It's innocent enough, heartfelt, but at times can lack that Chritmas feeling that we got from the original. But by the end of the film, the climax wraps up our sequel with an effective tug at our heartstrings and something to truly honor the memory of the first film. And for some, it will bring a tear to your eye. I'm giving A Chritmas Story Chritmas a jolly 3 stars. Now, before we get into the rest of the show, don't forget to check out my reviews for movies that just hit streaming and are available to rent or buy now, including The Super Rich, a Ted Cruz in the social satire Triangle of Sadness that cruised its way to 3.5 stars. The True Story about the Harvey Weinstein investigation that was an admirable attempt but lacked focus of messaging, received 2.5 stars. Dwayne Johnson joins the DC Universe in another disappointing DC film in Black Adam, in which he couldn't use the powers of the gods to push it past 1.5 stars. And finally, Viola Davis gives a performance of her career in The Woman King, which received a solid 3 stars. You can find those reviews on my previous episodes. And just a reminder, if you haven't yet, make sure you hit follow or subscribe and leave me a review on Apple Podcasts. And make sure you follow me on Instagram, Twitter, and Letterboxd at Movie Wire Show. Now, we have a couple things coming up on the Movie Wire. First and foremost, if you haven't yet, make sure you check out my appearance on the Casting Views podcast, where I join Casting Views to discuss the topic of urban legends, from the most common legends of Bigfoot to Loch Ness to giant cats to Richard Gere. Things get a little out of control, and this is one not to miss. Make sure you take a listen and make sure you follow these fine gents. Next, we have some big news with not only reviewing the upcoming Avatar Way of the Water on the show, and I am excited to say that I will be joining the Talking Smack podcast on their show with Josh and Alex to go more into an in-depth discussion. This will be my first appearance on one of my go-to shows, the Talking Smack podcast, and I cannot wait to hear Josh and Alex's thoughts on this film. I love these guys. And finally and lastly, make sure you listen up for a future announcement of a very special episode where I join my buddy Insomnio once again on the Cult Worthy podcast. He has a fantastic show set up and I cannot wait to dive into this topics with him once again. And this one is surely one not to miss. Again, follow the Twitter feed at Movie Wire Show for future announcements and when that episode will come out. Now we're going to hear from another podcast that I usually listen to during my lunchtime to get a mental break from the daily grind. These two are pure magic together on the mic and know exactly how to add some spice to your day. I'm talking about Jay and Kay over at the F*** My Workplace podcast. Let's hear from Jay and Kay now.
Have you ever had a bad day at work?
Well, the F*** My Work-Life podcast is perfect for you.
Hosts Jay and Kay share listeners' entertaining stories from the workplace, which may have you thinking, you don't have it so bad after all.
Find F*** My Work-Life on your favorite podcast platform.
When a group of mercenaries attack the estate of a wealthy family, old Saint Nick must step in to save the day and Christmas in Violent Night.
You ain't driving, are you?
I steer a little, but the reindeer do most of the work.
It's Christmas!
What is it?
That is a direct hotline to Santa Claus himself.
I can talk to Santa.
Welcome to your worst Christmas ever. $300 million. That's what I want for Christmas.
Santa, are you there?
I don't want any trouble, okay?
Are you gonna help us, Santa?
Santa Claus is coming to town.
Santa?
These bad men, they're all on my naughty list. For some season's beatings.
I believe in you, Santa.
There are movies out there that know exactly the audience they're shooting for, the type of movie where it's almost a parody of itself. Many have attempted this formula and have mostly been successful, or they've been complete flops, at least at the entertainment aspect of what the creators were trying to go after. Snakes on a Plane came to mind when watching the trailer to this film with a tiny mix of Die Hard. Snakes on a Plane was completely self-aware of what it was going after, and what made it successful is that it stuck to its guns and the ridiculousness of it, and even at times doubled down going into the second half of the movie. Now, if you have seen the previews to Violent Night, the trailer is filled with a hint of violence, epic one-liners, and a clear vision of a good time at the theater. For those that are looking for a Christmas cheesy, violent, entertaining ride for adults, that instead of Christmas bells, that you can almost hear Steven Seagal and Arnold Schwarzenegger's subtleties from the 80s ring in your ears. Now, this is the type of movie I prepared myself for by going to the concession stand and grabbing my medium popcorn, and instead of my normal bottle of water, I treated myself to a sugary Coke. Violent Night starts off on a good note. Well, if you enjoy bodily fluid spewing out onto another person, but it gives us what the audience wants and it sucks us into what would be the audience bought tickets for. The movie stars David Harbour as our Santa Claus, who most people remember recently from Stranger Things and Marvel's Black Widow. Now Santa is losing faith in Christmas that we discover after he takes a pit stop at a local bar. Meanwhile, we have our divorced couple, Jason Lightstone and Linda, played by Alex Hassel and Alexis Lauder, who have a daughter, Trudy, played by the brilliant Leah Brady. who has a normal standardized Christmas wish to have their parents back together, and she still has a strong belief in the man in the red suit. The family travels to the Lightstone Lavish Rich Lightstone Estate for Christmas to spend it with Jason's mother, Gertrude, played by a pleasant surprise of Beverly D'Angelo, who of course is worth millions and has millions on hand on Christmas Eve to ensure the plot of a home invasion happens. Now, of course, this is a recycled cliche plot, but it can be forgiven if we have the filmmakers and writers with a clear vision of not taking themselves too seriously. Violent Night has a strong first half as we get introduced to our villains led by the perfectly played John Leguizamo, who is only known as the codename Scrooge. The movie starts to tread downhill on an identity crisis as our hostage takers take over the home in hopes to receive millions of dollars. You can tell writers Pat Casey and Josh Miller had trouble transitioning to keep the same balance and the fun from the first half. They start to focus too much on the seriousness and negativity of our villains and can't seem to keep the contrasting tone between Santa and our villains. Now, Pat Casey and Josh Miller are the team that wrote both the Sonic the Hedgehog movies that I did enjoy, but these two movies also suffered in a character behavioral balance at times in the second half. This leaves it to director Tommy Wirkula to help to give the impression of balance through tone, and this isn't his forte in creating an environment or giving the audience an environment to really engage with, and most of the time, his environment comes across as generic. Now, we have seen this generic work from him in the past, more notably Hansel and Gretel Witch Hunters. He sticks with his comfortable dark and grayish tones with nothing added to the environment. It's just a bland setting. Violent Night isn't without its fun, though. The dynamic between the Lightstone family in its entirety is fun to watch, even though at times it can play it too safe. The performances make it engaging to stay with them through this heist. But more importantly, when it comes to our Santa, again played by David Harmer, he plays a disgruntled Santa extremely well. But as we get into some origin stuff of our Santa, that seems completely unnecessary because the filmmakers don't make it relevant enough to really move the plot along. It's kind of a pointless little tidbit that has no reason being in the movie, and the audience doesn't really care. They just want a Santa to say some cheesy jokes, kick some ass, and give us some good one-liners. There has been a recent movie from 2020 that depicts Santa in a non-traditional way, in a violent way, and that was Fat Man, starring Mel Gibson as Santa. Fat Man plays as a more gritty and serious take about the Santa tale, dealing with declining belief in Santa, who teams up with the government to manufacture weapons. Now, both these films get the balance wrong, but Fat Man at least stays consistent in its delivery. If it wasn't for the energetic performance from John Leguizamo, the second half of the movie would have been a complete snooze fest. The medium popcorn I got halfway through before my thumb and index finger laid rest upon my chin and cheek, with my head going limp against them, waiting for the spirit of the first half to come back to my life. My popcorn was cold by the time that happened, and by the time my hand went in for another scoop of popcorn, the moment it started to feel the spirit come back, it was over by the time I was able to get the popcorn to my mouth. Violent Night starts us off like we're in for an entertaining treat for the holidays, but it gets lost along the way on what it wants to be. And that's not to say holistically it isn't entertaining. John Leguizamo and the idea keeps it entertaining enough to be a good escape for a couple hours. If you're looking for something to take your holiday frustrations out and have a beer or a nice bourbon and witness old Saint Nick break some bones, set fire, wield a giant hammer, and also have a clever kill with a fireplace that actually was pretty cool, the frustration of what this could have been overshadows the experience of what we got, and that's in no thanks to the marketing of this film. But for what it is, it's a decent average watch, and honestly, I will most likely visit this next holiday season. But it misses the mark on too many things to give it a strong recommendation. I'm giving Violent Night 2.5 stars.
Where's your Christmas spirit?
Two sisters, Macy and Savannah, played by Toni Collette and Anna Faris, attempt to win over their terminally ill, difficult-to-please Aunt Hilda, played by Kathleen Turner, in hopes of becoming the beneficiaries to her wealthy estate, only to find the rest of their greedy family members have the same idea in the new film, The Estate.
Aunt Hilda's dying. Cancer.
And I don't really care.
Mom, she's your sister.
I know, but you know what a bitch she is.
Are you thinking what I'm thinking?
Aunt Hilda is never going to write us into her will. She doesn't even like us.
She doesn't like anybody. In case you haven't noticed, our business is going down the tubes and our lives are falling apart.
Let's go get rich from that dying old bitch.
Aunt Hilda? We heard you weren't well.
You think the sight of you two is going to cheer me up? Are you dim?
Oh, Cousin Beatrice is here from New York, huh?
And she thinks that the sun shines out of my ass.
We know why you're here. Do you think we look like idiots?
Do you really want me to answer that question?
Hey,
Hey, cousins! What's up?
No!
I wouldn't lose touch with Aunt Hilda. I'm not a complete idiot. Macy, Mercy, you are looking ready, ready fine.
So, Richard,
call me Dick. I like Dick now.
Dick.
Oh, you like Dick now?
I prefer Dick.
You seem to have caught the sun today, Hilda. You've got a little bit of a glow.
It's jaundice.
It looks good on you.
We need to keep an eye on Beatrice and Dick. They're trying to take our money.
I was just out buying flowers for my favorite aunt.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I'm ready to go up to bed.
Aunt Hilda, Macy and I can take one.
This is my job.
I thought I'd make you a photo album.
I had such a crush on Bill Gunther. I'll probably never feel a man inside me again.
If I wasn't your nephew, I'd be only too happy to be inside you.
If we get her laid by her high school crush, we have a shot.
Have you ever thought about sex with an older woman?
I'm not gonna do it.
You are so selfish.
Richard.
Just have fun with it.
I have completely lost sight of what we're doing here.
What the hell is wrong with you people?
We have always had a thing, you and me.
Our thing being that we're in the same family.
Yeah, we're just cousins. Cousins are fair game. Maybe even have some kids. Not naturally, you know, in case they came out weird.
The Estate was written and directed by Dean Craig, who has always attempted numerous chaotic situation comedies, such as Death at a Funeral, A Few Best Men, Moonwalkers, and Love, Wedding, Repeat. Now, whoever is motivating Dean Craig, or being that one friend that says, hey, Dean, you're the best at creating funny, chaotic situation comedies, whoever you are, stop it immediately. Now, I have no problem in Craig practicing with each situation comedy he comes out with, but usually writers and directors get better with each movie, or you can find bits and pieces of each movie as a shining light. Craig is getting worse. Craig is going in the wrong direction with each new comedy he comes out with, and his new film, The Estate, that is his worst film to date. What makes this frustrating is the fact that Craig's films, he usually has a stellar cast, and this one's no different. The cast includes Toni Collette, Anna Faris, Kathleen Turner, David Duchovny, and Ron Livingston. And this is also what we call a wasted batch of talent. The chemistry shows up like they all showed up for a table script read, and this isn't due in part to the performances. The cast does what they can with the utterly awful material presented to them. The cast has nothing to work with in this bland script. Not one character has anything interesting to say, and Craig puts these characters that apparently were close as kids into this game of wits to win over Aunt Hilda, but we get no sense or hint they were even ever close. Even more so, these characters are all written like they all got off the dumb truck. The only character that was mildly engaging to watch in all of his creepiness is David Duchovny as a sexually driven Richard. Now, you can tell the movie wanted to give Aunt Hilda almost a mysterious ulterior motive vibe, like we're in for a good twist or a game of manipulation from her part. The Estate tries to copy the 1994 film Greedy, starring Michael J. Fox, Ed Begley Jr., Nancy Travis, and the late great Phil Hartman and Kirk Douglas. No, I'm not saying that film was a complete masterpiece, but what it did do well was give us characters that were truly funny, introduced us to situations that kept our attention on what the cast was going to do next, had a bright tone, and kept us on our toes on what the endgame was. You can also feel the fun from watching the performances in the 1994 Greedy. And we take the cast from The Estate that gives off the feeling they're being held against their will to shoot this movie. And while you're watching it, you're just waiting for one of the cast members to hold up a sign that reads, "Help us." If there was a movie that was a copy yet contradiction, this would be it. You can sense that Dean Craig may have saw the 1994 movie Greedy and said, "I want to do that, but in my own way," in which movie over movie, this man doesn't show a funny bone in his body. So he goes ahead and adds some grim, gray, dark tones, and instead of adding situations, he just makes the characters just kind of fight amongst themselves. And when he does add a situation to give off the chaotic feel, it just feels thrown in and forced. The main problem I have with this film is that it doesn't push the envelope. Craig starts to introduce a situation, and it truly does have the potential of being something funny. But right when the situation is introduced, Craig folds his cards and relies on the audience to picture something else funny that could have happened. There is no risk-taking in this, and if Craig truly wants to continue his work in creating films like this, he has to come out of his shell and hit the throttle without hitting the brakes. The one thing I will say about our cast of characters, if I could come up with something positive, is that it does an okay job with likability with each of them. Even though they are completely boring and have nothing interesting to say, there's not one character that we 100% say I don't want them to get the inheritance. But I'm actually torn whether the characters are likable or they're just kind of blended together with the exact same personalities. And whether that's the intent or a good thing or a bad thing, I have no clue, nor do I care. I just wanted to find a positive somewhere in this mess of a movie, and there it is. The estate is a pointless situation romp that tries to be something that the written material doesn't support, and our cast tries their hardest, but by the second half of the movie, they realize they're wasting their time. And by the time the credits roll, I realize I wasted my time. The Estate will most likely be on my list for one of the worst movies of the year. I'm giving The Estate 1 star. It's so hard to keep track and even have time to read all the trending topics on the web. Now there's a new app to help with all of those problems. Newsly is an audio app for iOS and Android. It picks up web articles about the most trending topics on the web at any given moment and reads them to you in a natural human voice. For the first time in the history of the internet, the entire web becomes listenable. Browse articles from topics you choose and start playing. You can follow any topic as specific as you like, from sports, science, to Bitcoin. You can even follow Kardashian. It will find you the latest articles and read them to you out loud. And guess what? They have podcasts as well. Explore trending podcasts from over 50 countries. The Movie Wire is now a featured podcast on the Newsly app. Download and use Newsly for free now. The link will be in the description of this episode. You can also use one of my promo codes that you will find in the description as well to get you a 1 month free premium subscription. Stop scrolling, start listening, download Newsly today. Based on the true story and the book by Adam Makos, a pair of U.S. Navy fighter pilots risk their lives during the Korean War and become some of the Navy's most celebrated wingmen in devotion.
The North Koreans came pouring over the 38th parallel.
This is war, and we're up.
We knew this day might come.
Doesn't make it any easier.
Commanding officer called you one of the best pilots he's ever seen.
It must be hard being the
naval aviator. It's the toughest job there is.
Did you ever think that you'd be in a squadron with a colored aviator?
I can't tell you how many times people have told me to give up, quit, die even. That's why you can't always do what you're told.
What do you want me to do?
Just be my wingman.
You belong in the sky, Jesse.
It's a man!
Just remember you belong down here with us too, okay?
Red fire, Jesse!
I need everyone sharp and ready.
Those boys are holding on by their fingernails. We bring everyone home.
Ready, set, hit!
Remember what you're fighting for.
Show off.
That was pretty good.
It's good.
In a time of a nation divided by segregation, there are many stories of heroism to tell during these times of war, politics, racism, to the tiniest acts of hope that have been forgotten by the little time that has passed. Devotion is a type of movie where casting and the writing is everything. The stakes are higher to ensure the film is told in an accurate manner, but also to hold true to the original source material. Devotion takes a harrowing tale that's based on a true story about Jesse Brown, played by Jonathan Majors, who earned his pilot wings in 1948, which earned a flood of media attention that the film hints at. Jesse Brown was a devoted husband and also devoted to his country. Jesse's wife, Daisy Brown, played by Christina Jackson. Daisy and Jesse have a wonderful chemistry and truly give a humble performance that shows almost like a looking glass into the segregation of daily life, but also their love of one another and their love of life. Both performances hold strong in the values of the Brown family, especially in a basic world that demonstrates hate at home, even in the time of war. Jesse Brown is teamed up in a flight test with the newly reassigned Tom Hudner, played by Glenn Powell. There is one piece casting director Tamara Lee Notcutt gets wrong: to give Glenn Powell a green light to be on the short list to star in this movie. I would almost be curious who else was up for this role, given such an underwhelming performance by Powell. Glenn Powell gives off almost a Tom Cruise impersonation type of performance, but it comes across as a farce. His body language and facial expressions don't match the dialogue, and it's hard to take him seriously when he delivers his lines. His facial expressions always seem to have an overconfident and smug look, even when the script demands to be humble. He comes across unlikable throughout the the film. The only thing that gives Powell credibility is the written material, just not the way he delivers it. But Jonathan Majors steals the show in his subtle but powerful performance and the portrayal of Jesse Brown. Majors takes the material, which already doesn't feel over-dramatized, with his character, and he doesn't try and make it over-dramatized. To be center stage, even though he is the biggest part of the film. The film was written by newcomers Jack Crane and Jonathan Stewart, where you can feel the amateurish basics in the writing of this film, but here it actually works. It doesn't feel forced, it doesn't feel over-dramatized, it feels real, and I applaud most of the cast for treating it as such. It shows true respect to the story of Brown and the history behind it. The only thing that lacks when it comes to the writing is a better buildup and depth into the chemistry between Brown and Hudner. The writing is missing more to the relationship when it comes to the build, and by the time we reach the climax, the actions are emotional along with the story behind it, but we don't have more historic depth into the accounts of our two pilots' history. And when we do see them on screen, this is where our two new writers tend to miss the mark and keep it almost too basic, where it doesn't flow like a normal conversation. And when we do see the two on screen, a mix of the writing and Powell's smug facial expressions ruins the little chemistry the two already had. There's a sense of mistrust that Brown has towards Hudner, and I can't say I blame him. If I had this guy giving me a mischievous grin for most of our interactions and almost the entire runtime of the film, I would be asking myself, why the hell does this guy keep grinning at me like a Disney villain? Even when we get to the emotional climax, you can tell Powell struggles with the emotional performances, and it's out of his element and out of his norm. The feel of the movie is not one that really follows the cliche feel of the standard post-war movies. It's almost a lighter feel, to which it takes a bit of adjusting to the mind, especially given the dark topics of war and racism. Even when we get to some of the ground war scenes, we get a brighter tone that we normally don't see in scenes of horror. It's almost like director J.D. Dillard wanted to ensure the focus on the characters on screen, in which I would find a smart decision in most cases, but the dialogue is too basic for this, especially with how little we know about the characters that are shown in battle. And in this case, the darker tone shown in a battle fought at night would have been more appropriate to focus on the horror of war versus the characters that we barely know. The battle scenes are not effective, but mostly because the filmmakers bank on our already horror and feelings of emotion towards war. And the sound mix doesn't help with those emotions. It sounds extremely flat, and it's almost like somebody pressing a button on a soundboard while the scenes are being shot. Our new writers and directors show their flaws of being new in their respected seats during the film, but for the magnitude of this motion picture, there are more positives to come out than negatives. Now here's a main point in question. Was Dillard using the story of Jesse Brown to tell just a story, or to inspire a message to its audiences? This remains unclear by the time the credits roll, but the success of the film was to show heroism and bravery of Jesse Brown, and this wasn't effective in doing so. And this is thanks to the writing and supporting talent of Jonathan Majors. There's a lot to like and root for in this movie, but what is not clear if it's our moral human nature of feeling of what to root for these characters, or for getting this emotion from the talents of the creators. To me, it's the latter of both, and those not familiar with the Jesse Brown story will come out learning something new. Without an over-dramatized historical biopic that comes at the end of the year, it gives the audience something to take away with some solid performances, mostly by everybody. Sorry, Glenn Powell, you're the mostly. And you will walk out of the cinema taking something away that you didn't start with. I'm giving Devotion 3 stars. And that's a cut on this week's edition of The Movie Wire. Again, thank you all for listening, and thank you for your support. You can also show support by following me on Instagram, Twitter, and Letterboxd at Movie Wire Show. Until next week, do me a favor. Make sure you stay for after the credits to show the respect for those that put their blood, sweat, and tears into making a feature film. And make sure you support your local movie theaters.
Merry Christmas, Movie Home!
A verdict has been made on this episode of The Movie Wire by your host, Justin Hansen. He thanks you for listening to the show. You can follow Justin on Instagram and Twitter at Movie Wire Show, or visit his website, www.themoviewire.com. Oh, and don't forget to leave a review on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. I'm sure he'd love to hear from you. Until next time, we will see you at the movies.
Thank you for bringing me to the movies.